Abiogenesis. Abiogenesis is the claim that the original life can be best explained by non-living chemistry. The advocates for abiogenesis use scientific sounding arguments to prove their case. However, are such arguments really reasonable, or are there serious flaws into them? Well, let's find out. Argument number one. It's been commonly argued by proponents of abiogenesis that the probability against abiogenesis is completely useless if you consider given enough time. In this argument, time is used as a resolution for the dilemma of astronomical odds against abiogenesis. Now, putting this in layman terms, given enough time, abiogenesis can happen regardless what the odds are. That is because the odds against abiogenesis are meaningless if you consider time, or simply given enough time. Now, at first sight, this may seem as a reasonable argument, and I do in fact agree that time can make the unlikely more likely and eventually make it inevitable in the long run. However, there are serious problems with this argument, and I would like to address why that is the case. The problem with using abiogenesis as an infinite process is the fact that RNA bases, adenine, cytosine, guanine, and uracil are extremely limited and unstable in high temperatures. In the article, The Stability of the RNA Bases, Implications for the Original Life, published by Matthew Levy and Stanley L. Miller, the authors argue that RNA bases are extremely unstable depending on the temperature of the environment. The higher the temperature is, the less time those RNA bases have before they become decayed. Now, when they become decayed, it leaves a serious threat and dilemma to the abiogenesis, because it is almost virtually impossible for RNA molecules to form, since there will be no RNA bases left because they have decayed in a very short amount of time due to the high temperatures of the environment. Now, you may be asking yourself, so what? Well, actually, the so what is a big problem. According to the authors, at least in 100 degrees Celsius, which is above 200 degrees Fahrenheit, the RNA bases, adenine and guanine, half-life is 1 year, while the uracil only lasts for 2 years, and cytosine only lasts for 19 days. Now, what does this mean? It means that the abiogenesis process must have happened extremely rapidly, given the extremely limited amount of time those RNA bases have before they become decayed, suggesting that those RNA bases must bond together in less than 20 years and extremely rapidly, otherwise there will be no life whatsoever. Now, this is completely contradictory and quite devastating for the proponents of abiogenesis, given that they believe that the process of abiogenesis must take at least 1 million years in order to account for the original life. However, since RNA bases are extremely lethal to high temperatures, it is therefore reasonable to conclude that there is no such thing as infinite process in abiogenesis, and there is no such thing as given enough time as the proponents want you to believe. Now, given enough time, there is no such thing as given enough time in abiogenesis. Now, the truth is, abiogenesis, at least in the process in which RNA molecules form, is extremely time limited depending on the temperature of the environment. As I had said before, the higher the temperature is, the less time those RNA bases have before they become decayed and all life as we know it become non-existent. Now, the only way the proponents can go around this dilemma is if they assume that the process of abiogenesis with those RNA bases occurred in very low temperatures, at least in several degrees Celsius, which is about 32 degrees Fahrenheit, using the logic or advice of the authors in the article. However, saying so does not indicate that's how abiogenesis happened. The burden of proof lies on proponents to prove that the early Earth was extremely cold, or at least low temperature, as the authors advised. If they cannot demonstrate such evidence, then there is no reason to accept their claim of abiogenesis of RNA molecules form in very low temperatures. Now, moving on to the second argument. This argument is going to be based on the ridiculous odds against chance of protein synthesis. I'm pretty sure it can be agreed upon atheists and proponents of abiogenesis that they encounter ridiculous odds against chance of a single functional protein forming by chance alone. Abiogenesis proponents do not debate whether or not those probabilities are true or not. However, what they do debate and disagree on is that those odds against chance are a serious threat to abiogenesis. Now, this is usually because they believe in self-organization. They believe that those protein synthesis is a non-random process, and therefore using the argument against odds against chance is completely meaningless. However, is there really any truth to this claim? The answer is no, and I will explain why. Usually, proponents of abiogenesis use self-organization mechanisms to debunk the odds against chance of a single protein forming. This mechanism is usually based on RNA interacting with the ribosome. Their argument goes something like this. Nucleotides in DNA code RNA. RNA splices into mRNA, and the ribosome reads the mRNA. Whereas the codons, which are basically three mRNAs, code for amino acids, and those amino acids become organized into complex polypeptides, which is how proteins are formed in biological organisms. This argument tends to act as a rebuttal against the odds against chance of a single protein forming, because it is nature that is organizing and ordering the amino acids non-randomly to form a single functional protein. Because of this, there is no reason to bother the arguments of abiogenesis regarding odds against chance of a single protein forming, since they are completely ignorant and stupid coming out from the mouths of creationists, or at least that's what atheists and the proponents call them. However, as always, there are serious flaws with the reasoning, and I'm going to prove once and for all why self-organization theory does not stand up to the hype when it comes to the formation of protein synthesis, and why the argument the odds against chance of a single functional protein forming is indeed valid. Now, in order to understand why this self-organization theory cannot stand up to the hype using the laws of nature, it is important to distinguish the two ways nature works. One way that nature works is known as order, and the other way is complexity. Alright, so let's get started. The bases in the coding region of a section of DNA or in an RNA transcript are typically arranged in a non-repetitive manner. These sections of genetic test display what information scientists call complexity, not simply order or redundancy. Now, to see the difference between order and complexity, consider the difference between the following sequences. NaCl, 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 which is basically sodium chloride. And consider the bottom sequence, AZFRT less than MPGRTSHKLKYR. The first sequence, which is basically the chemical structure of salt crystals, displays what information scientists call redundancy or simply order. That's because the two constituents, sodium and chloride, are highly ordered in the sense of being arranged in a simple, rigidly repetitive way. The sequence on the bottom, by contrast, exhibits complexity. In this randomly generated string of characters, there is no simply repetitive pattern, whereas the sequence on the top could be generated by a simple rule or a computer algorithm, such as every time sodium arises, attach Cl to it and or vice versa. No rule shorter than the sequence itself could generate the second sequence. The information-rich sequences in DNA, RNA, and proteins, however, by contrast, are characterized not by either simple order or mere complexity, but instead by specified complexity. In such sequences, the irregular and unpredictable arrangement of the characters or constituents is critical to the function that the sequence performs. The three sequences below illustrate these distinctions. NaCl, 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 which is basically order. ACFRT less than MPGRTSHKLKYR, which is basically complexity, which are the laws of nature. Order and complexity are the laws of nature and what they create. However, when it comes to time and tide wait for no man, it is actually specified complexity. Now, what does all this have to do with self-organization? Simple. The law-like self-organizing process that generate the kind of order present in the crystal or vortex do not also generate complex sequences or structures. Still less do they generate specified complexity, the kind of order present in the gene or functionally complex organ or genetic information. Laws of nature, by definition, describe repetitive phenomena, order in the sense that can be just transcribed with differential equations or universal if-then statements. Consider, for example, these informal expressions of the law of gravity. All unsupported bodies fall, or if an elevated body is left suspended, then it will fall. These statements represent reasonably accurate law-like descriptions of natural gravitational phenomena, precisely because we have repeated experience of unsupported bodies falling to the earth. In nature, repetition provides grist for lawful description. The information-bearing sequences in protein-coding DNA and RNA molecules, however, do not exhibit such repetitive order. As such, these sequences can be neither described nor explained by reference to a natural law or law-like self-organization process. The kind of non-repetitive order on display in DNA and RNA, a really precise sequential order necessary to ensure function, is not the kind of laws of nature or law-like self-organization process can, in principle, generate or explain. Because of this, there is no reason to suggest that nature is capable of self-organizing amino acids to form functional proteins. Because functional proteins contain non-repetitive and very specified complex information sequences. Because of this, the argument that the self-organization of the ribosome non-randomly creating functional proteins under protein synthesis is therefore invalid, since nature cannot generate such specified complexity. As I have stated before, nature can only create order in the sense that it is extremely repetitive as well as complexity, but that does not contain any real significant information. Giving order-like repetitive sequences to the process of protein synthesis is actually pretty useless, since it will not be capable of generating functional proteins. That is because functional proteins do not come from repetitive order-like sequences. They come from really specific sequences set in a really specific manner. Now, another problem with the probability of getting a functional protein is the fact that the functional protein must be set in the right three-dimensional complex in order to receive the function. In other words, even if the amino acids are set in the right sequences or combination, that still does not form the function that is needed or required for biological life. Be that is because the protein has yet to form a three-dimensional complex fold in order to obtain that function. However, if the protein is set in the wrong three-dimensional fold, then there is no function and eventually end up with a useless or harmful protein. So, unfortunately for abiogenesis, it has to rely on chance and hopefully that the amino acids get set in the right place with the right genetic information that is set in a really specific and highly specified manner. However, the probability of that happening is extremely low. Now, that doesn't mean that it's impossible. However, it does mean that it's virtually impossible, statistically speaking. Now, the third argument used in abiogenesis are RNA self-replicating molecules and RNA enzymes, or simply ribozymes. It is believed by abiogenesis proponents that there were RNA self-replicating molecules during the time of abiogenesis, as well as RNA enzymes that help perform specific function of RNA. Now, there were serious problems, once again, with these arguments. The thing is, self-replicating RNAs that have been manufactured in a lab actually are not truly self-replicable. Instead, those self-replicating RNAs that were synthesized in labs actually replicate only a small portion of the RNA compared to everything. Now, this is a problem because RNA in abiogenesis is required of total true self-replication in order to account for abiogenesis. But abiogenesis that is synthesized in the labs, RNA that is synthesized in the labs, however, does not truly self-replicate itself, since it only replicates a really small portion of it, which could be another dilemma if I'm not mistaken. Now, moving on to the other hand, RNA enzymes, or simply ribozymes, are basically special RNA molecules that help catalyze as well as perform specific functions of the RNA. However, the problem is that ribozymes do not perform the same function as enzymes. While ribozymes, on the other hand, are extremely limited compared to enzymes. This is because enzymes, which are special proteins, perform all the necessary functions that is necessary for life, while ribozymes, which are basically special RNA molecules, only perform a very small portion of the limit of the functionality, which makes their functionality pretty much limited. To give this a better analogy, imagine a construction worker is asked to build a house. An enzyme will be basically having all the tools necessary to build a house. However, a ribozyme only has a very limited amount of tools. For example, only a hammer. Obviously, you cannot build a house from a hammer. Well, that's exactly what ribozymes do. Their functionality is extremely limited compared to the enzymes. Now, there is this response or criticism that says that even though ribozymes are incapable of performing all the functions, having ribozymes perform the work together would actually solve the problem. However, the problem about this is that ribozymes, they're actually independent molecules. They do not work together. In order for the RNA to account for all the tasks that are necessary, the ribozymes will actually have to work together dependently. However, if those ribozymes do not cooperate, then the functionality is not established for the necessary functions of RNA. So having more ribozymes does not resolve that dilemma. Now, why is the ribozymes important for abiogenesis? Well, the reason why they are important is because they play a significant role in protein synthesis. If the ribozymes do not perform all the necessary functions that RNA is asking for, then the protein synthesis cannot be established, and therefore resulting into the dilemma for abiogenesis. So, to sum everything up, we know that abiogenesis suffers with numerous dilemmas. One dilemma is the fact that RNA bases are extremely unstable depending on the temperature of the environment. And another dilemma is that we know that nature is incapable of creating specified complexity information that is necessary for a functional protein. And we also know that RNAs are incapable of self-replicating truthfully, as well as the fact that ribozymes do not perform the necessary functions that are necessary to establish protein synthesis and other RNA tasks, and including the fact that you cannot have a functional protein even if you have the amino acids set in the right sequence, because you need to have the right third-dimensional complex fold, protein fold. Alright, so thanks for watching.